These interventions are technocratic because of the belief in technology-based solutions for social problems, as well as the faith and rule of experts, consultants, corporate managers, bureaucrats. But they're also nationalist because of the discourse of sacrifice, pride, community, sovereignty that they're imbued with. It's constantly used to, you know, re-legitimize these interventions. So I would say that actually it's a kind of technocratic nationalism that enables these interventions. Now, the reason I think it's useful to think of this as something that's manufactured through the policies is because the initiatives are carried out as efficient, as a kind of, you know, the launch of a new regime which is less bloated, less corrupt, less inefficient, but usually through bypassing democratic debate. But in doing that, in the name of efficiency and formality, it actually conceals the informal networks of privilege and access that elites themselves enjoy. So looking at it as technocratic nationalism, bringing them together is an effort to question the efficiency and formality it is masked with. With that, I would say that the effect of this technocratic nationalism is a kind of othering which engenders forced assimilation at best and dehumanization and exclusion at worst. And this othering, I would borrow the idea of Rob Nixon, which is the unimagined other. And these are communities that do not lie beyond national boundaries, but rather are unimagined communities who are internal to the space of the nation state, but communities whose vigorously unimagined condition becomes indispensable to the maintenance of a highly selective discourse of national development. What this basically means is these are people who are intentionally made invisible in development discourse. Their history, their time, the structures that cause their situation are completely silenced or made invisible in order to make a certain other nation in whose name development is carried out more prominent, right? So, and these then come out as the surplus people. You would see in the cities, for instance, those who've been displaced in the villages because of development projects, or they come as the developmental refugees. But what allows this to happen is a kind of spatial amnesia of communities. Now, Rob Nixon had written this, developed this concept in light of the work of Arundhati Roy in relation to mega dams and mega projects. But I see the same thing happening with the, you know, projects around smart cities, and I've not looked into the demonetization as much, so I'll stay with that initiative. Because in different ways, it brings together elite perceptions of the poor in order to, unimagine them. So for instance, if you look at the policy reports as well, which are somewhat less vociferous, there is no reference to the structural basis of poverty, but they're treated as an aspirant class, right? So the notion of smart cities is that, well, they want exactly what the middle class wants, and we've done a disservice to them by thinking that they want state largesse, right? They want an opportunity and let them have that. But if you look at the IT sector, which is the second elite discourse, of course, I deal with, they treat them as mass labor, and the idea that the knowledge economy of the present should focus on highly skilled professionals and not the bricks and mortar economy of the past and the mass labor. So the idea of the surplus people coming in there. But then going thirdly to the middle class discourses, which is very much at the center of such initiatives, and you see, since this regime has come in, I see middle class a lot more in formal policy documents than ever before, is directly treated as nuisance, right? So the rhetoric that poverty is a nuisance, it's unsightly and should be excluded away. So you see it in different degrees. Now, what I find in this technocratic nationalism is the coming together of different elite discourses which originate in very different spheres, right? Middle class discourse in just everyday talk, to IT sector consultancy reports, to policy documents, which share similar worldviews, right, similar assumptions and have this ability to come together and create a, one social construct around development, around, for, let's say, urban region or generation, ending corruption and so on. So they develop one social construct, which then becomes the basis of policy. Now, one could argue that why look at this as a kind of coalition of discourses or a discourse coalition when you could actually use the concept of hegemony, right? So, for instance, one could argue that the concept of hegemony, which refers to manufactured consent for the dominant ideology of the ruling bloc, addresses this point, and therefore smart cities can simply be seen as a manifestation of neoliberal ideological dominance. However, while this perspective denaturalizes the operation of dominance as something that's not given, but is constantly made and remade, it does not capture the differences and nuances of elite discourses. Furthermore, while formal policy to some extent gets tempered down with political contestation of different kinds, the power of elite discourse coalition lies not so much in unproblematically universalizing ideas, but rather in achieving the legitimation to operate outside of normal political processes, as we can see with the smart cities mission. So one of the main instruments, for instance, for delivering smart cities is through special purpose vehicles. So this is new capital city coming up, Amravati for Andhra Pradesh, it's just sort of, you know, going to happen regardless. So one of the, that's the reason it's important to look at it separately, and it also corrects certain assumptions that the idea of hegemony is that the ideas are the same, but when you look at, for instance, the middle class discourses, it has nothing to do with neoliberalism. It is just, you know, around aesthetic rationality, around seeing poverty as a nuisance. So it has nothing to do with those ideas as such. So those differences also come up. Another feature of this is that the way in which it poverty is translated as an issue of meeting material aspirations. And as I told you, this transformation of seeing poverty as something to do with aspirations rather than structural comes in different ways across these discourses, and you see it in different degrees. And that's important also to kind of get those differences into the surface. So I'm going to just throw a few of the sort of evidence of this, these elite discourses now. I'm sure a number of you are familiar with the Smart Cities Mission, so I'm not going to labor too much on it, but it was launched in May 2015. And it's amongst other things, it's basically a mission which conceives urbanization as a business model, where municipal managers are encouraged to turn their cities into investor-friendly havens. Now, it's a model that Narendra Modi had tried in Gujarat and then took it to the national level. Anyway, there are three discourses that have come together there. The first is Narendra Modi's own version of high-tech populism. There is the high IT sector's, what I call as technotopia or technological utopias. And third is the middle class discourses of aesthetic rationality. And in each of these, I will just give you some evidence of how it works and what it says about the poor. Okay? So in Narendra Modi's high-tech populism, it appeals directly to what you could call as broadly aspirant people or the neo-middle classes, right? So already a middle class support base, but those who've just come out of poverty, living in the cities, and so refers directly to those interests, and it has firmly established a rhetoric around established and aspirational groups and show that they have a kind of fatigue with the political establishment's preoccupation with the curse of poverty and aspire for a house, for more wealth, and rather than depending on state largesse, want more speed and efficiency in building affluent world-class cities. Combined with this is also this fascination with technology, and this appeals to a young vote base, the, you know, the post-1990s generation who have witnessed the IT boom. there is another scholar called Ayona Dutta who writes about how for this generation being anti-technology is by extension being anti-national. Anyway, this high-tech populism, as you know, Modi is very astute at using the social media and other sort of forums. But it, in this version, as a leader, he appeals directly to the aspirant people and promises to circumvent all intermediaries and institutions and neutralizing institutions to realize their interests. So, for example, in the annual urban development report, which it opens with a statement by him, which is the first I've seen in many years of looking at these reports. It often never starts by the prime minister himself. It's usually a statement by the urban minister. So anyway, it starts with this statement: Amrut Smart Cities Mission and Housing for All mark a watershed moment in our quest to create better and futuristic cities. These initiatives mark a paradigm shift, providing a people-centric approach to create world-class urban spaces. But in this particular political discourse, people-centric means that people power is stronger and more important than institutions. So for instance, he has described this mission as a people's movement and not just a system for allocating money for various projects. And in fact, in some speeches, one speech he goes further to say, it's not that earlier no work was done in our country, nor was it that government did not spend budgets. Those of us who are in government, from the panchayat to leaders to the PM, have to know that if there's anyone smarter than us, then it is the citizen of the country. And he adds that if the strength of crores of citizens is consolidated, then we will not need government and the country will progress rapidly on its own. So basically, he appeals directly to the people and promises to bypass institutions in order to deliver. And in addition, also adds that, for instance, shows this faith in experts. So for instance, in urban activity, he says, the majority of work is technical, but manpower in cities is clerical, almost 95%. Clerks are bookkeeping, but they cannot develop the city. So the manpower should give more strength to the technocrats. So this reliance on experts appeals directly to what surveys have shown many middle classes want. So more recent surveys, I've looked at the World Value Survey, shows that when compared to any other class, middle classes would prefer to be ruled by experts rather than by politicians. So so this is, it also carries nationalist tones with statements like, why have so many countries in the world who got independence after us and who were more in debt than us have moved ahead of us? And basically this emphasis that India takes ages to complete projects and we should be able to do it faster. So the important thing here, however, is the way in which it turns how poverty is talked about. So poverty in this discourse is not so much a problem of access or exclusion, but rather the state's failure to recognize the material aspirations of the poor and to see how similar their aspirations are to that of the middle classes. So for instance, in one speech he suggests, there are two cities within a city. One is a city of those who serve and one is a city of those who receive services. He explains elsewhere that so far in Hindustan, the government's attitude was that people will be happy as long as the government gives them something. But this is injustice to those self-reliant people. They're searching for an opportunity to do something, to make a difference. And the opportunity he's referring to here is the city. The city is the financial growth center, and I believe that the strongest solution to poverty is the city. And he basically generalizes the mindset of the people as they believe that to move ahead, you have to have a footstep in the city. Now, this is the kind of high-tech populism. But then I looked at the IT sector reports, and it interestingly actually makes quite interesting comments on this as well, and there are some overlaps. So there has been a lot of criticism on this primacy given to technology as a solution for urban development. But what's interesting in the Indian context is that it also, so for instance, looking at IBM and McKinsey and all of these corporate storytellers. They propose a kind of economic model which is practiced in the richer countries in the world, that of cognitive cultural capitalism, which is basically focused more on a knowledge economy of highly skilled professionals rather than manufacturing. So they propose the same for India, and basically say that the city should cater to the top half of the labor sector and not that mass labor. Although this defies what recent data has shown, that even now the urban workforce in India is more in the informal sector than in the formal sector. But I found this quote by one consultant, which was basically saying that in order to enable this to happen, we need to create create exclusive zones for this knowledge economy of highly skilled labor. And this is what he suggests: when we build these smart cities, we will be faced with a massive surge of people who will desire to enter these cities. We will be forced to keep them out. Even with high prices, the conventional laws in India will not enable us to exclude millions of poor. Hence, the police will need to physically exclude people from such cities, and they will need a different set of laws from those operating in the rest of India for them to be able to do so. Creating special enclaves is the only method of doing so. Accordingly, the Smart City Mission sets out to build compact areas, not integrated areas, that can be a replicable model for other aspiring cities. So, clearly the notion that we need some, you can see, I don't want to labor on it. Anyway, the final discourse comes from the middle class. This is usually through residential welfare associations, and for a long time, I mean, middle class aspiration for a city is less tuned to local context and more to, the cities that feature in the most livable cities in the world. One knows that. And it concurs with ideas around India shining, the idea that India is an emerging power and cities should look more like that. But what's interesting is that more and more these middle class claims to the city, which basically say poverty is unsightly, is unaesthetic, have made their way into public interest litigations and have become the basis of slum clearance. So that's interesting, but if this nuisance talk, and Ashu Gartner writes about this is that how has it made its way from just, this kind of nuisance talk into court judgments. Now, some would again possibly use the hegemonic argument and say middle, there's this idea of middle class and hegemony, it's an instrument that's used, it's a kind of new rationality of rule and all that. But it's interesting that something that middle classes have been able to do through is actually play on this idea that they are isolated from politics, right? And therefore need the special privileges. And in fact, what I found from a lot of these public interest litigations is that they do not necessarily align with neoliberal ideals, but rather to a more narrow focus on the nuisance of poverty and the polluting and unaesthetic effects of slums, with a consistent desire to differentiate and delineate the poor outsiders from their inner life. So anyway, so I just saw this television debate with a person called Sanjay Kaul, who's the head of People's Action in Delhi, and it's a collection of residential welfare associations. And he was in a panel with a municipal leader and a local politician. And the discussion is on the master plan in Delhi, and the TV anchor says, throughout this discussion, one gentleman was quiet. Then looking at Sanjay Kaul, he says, "Why were you quiet?" SK's response is emblematic of a typical position that middle-class urban activists take. When such a discussion takes place, the normal man does not get much room to negotiate. Normal man meaning his own club. The television anchor asks, "Why does the normal man always move back from such discussions?" And he replies, Sanjay Kaul replies, "Unfortunately, he does not think that politics has space for him." But of course, this concurs with earlier research, ethnographic research, that wealthier people tend to go directly to government or take legal action to solve their local problems rather than go through networks of patronage. So anyway, these were the three discourses and their different versions the different aspirations and also ideas on poverty. But what I try to show here is they're not sort of technical or a certain kind of neutral aims for a better cities or anything normative, but they do carry tones of privilege, tones of exclusion, and do actively produce what I said earlier, the unimagined other. Now, what's interesting is that they have been continuously used in recent times to rationalize these projects in the face of contestation, and through that made these discourses around pride, community, sacrifice, and sovereignty much stronger. And we have seen that this is not just about neoliberal governmentality, but actually carry, you know, rhetorics around nuisance and intolerance. What makes this possible? What makes it possible for elite discourses to come together and get into what's called a structuration, become part of policy? Well, they share similar worldviews. Elite texts and talks are widely circulated through media, right? And they can easily make crossovers with each other. So for instance, middle class activists from these residential welfare associations have been quick to take up the promotion of digital technology, as you can see the same with demonetization as well, and promote public-private partnership. The IT sector also is quick to take ideas around development, economic growth, global power and influence. Together, however, I would go as far as arguing as just as in apartheid, elite narratives produced racial exclusion, technocratic nationalism produces unimagined others, others who are tied within nation state, but whose history, context, structures of exclusion are invisibilized. And in my view, the smart cities mission, like other missions, will have a legacy, not just in expanding the role of digital technology in urban development here, but in institutionalizing ideas that originate in elite discourses. These ideas have influence over how political and social institutions should be structured, how problems of exclusion and displacement should be addressed, and how development priorities decide the use to which public resources should be put. Therefore, by critically examining elite discourses that make up this discourse coalition, it's important to show the biases and silences that are masked in the technical language of policy. Thank you very much.